Can I welcome everyone to the 36th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2015? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices? No apologies received. And I welcome Graeme Pearson, who's coming to the session. Item 1, decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to consider item 5 and consideration of work programme in private. Are members agreed that we take this item in private? I'm now going to move on to an evidence session on the interception of communications by Police Scotland. The session follows a statement from the Interception of Communications Commission on 25th November, confirming that Police Scotland had contravened the acquisition and disclosure of communications data code of practice. And I'll let the witnesses settle in. We've gone swiftly because we've got a large agenda today. Thank you. I welcome our first panel of witnesses, Deputy Chief Constable Neil Richardson, designated Deputy for the Chief Constable Police Scotland, and John Foley, Chief Executive of the Scottish Police Authority. I thank you both for making yourselves available at short notice, and I'll go straight to questions from members. Roddy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I'm interested in the history of this matter prior to the publication of the Code of Practice in March 2015. As I understand it, in October 2014, the then Commissioner was asked to constitute an inquiry and to report, to launch an inquiry and then make an additional report to Prime Minister about various matters about the protection of journalistic sources, concerns about that, and allegations that the police have misused their powers under Chapter 2 of Part 1 of REPA. And then a report was published in February 2015, which covered a three-year period prior to that, in which it was indicated that 19 police forces had sought communications data in relation to 34 investigations into suspected illicit relationships between public officials and journalists. Were Police Scotland one of those 19 police forces? And what was the practice prior to March 2015 in relation to this matters?
Well, I mean, I suppose the reality around the whole set of arrangements for authorising activity in this kind of arena, it is subject to ongoing kind of guidance and annual checks by IOCO and the OSC, the Office of Surveillance Commissioner, on the other side of the business. And they, therefore, rigorously ensure that procedures are being followed and adhered to. In terms of the specific type of authorisation that we're referring to here today, it's fair to say that in the 3 years leading on from 2011, the Police Scotland and the legacy constituent elements of Police Scotland progressed 12 requests relating to this type of activity. Included within that 12 are the 5 that are subject to, I think, the arrangements that led to me attending here today to answer questions. Beyond that, there were 7 other applications. From those 7, 1 was rejected, 4 related to legacy force arrangements, and 2 related to Police Scotland. And crucially, within all 7 of those, they were subject to the normal scrutiny arrangements in place through the arrangements at that time, and were all found to be acceptable and within the guidance and the appropriate standards at that point.
I'm a wee bit confused just on one matter, which is you talk about 5 subject to today. In this report, I think, was published in February 2015 before the Code of Practice, and it refers to 19 forces and 34 investigations. I'm not quite sure from the chronology how that can include the 5. Surely it's the 7.
I don't have access to the specific report that you're referring to, and I can't therefore collate the 2. What I have done in readiness to come here today is look at the number relating specifically to Scotland, and what I'm telling you just now in terms of the 12 is what I believe to be the accurate position. I can't speak for the rest of the UK in relation to the 19.
Well, can you just talk us through how you would have approached the 7, leave the 5 aside for the moment, prior to the publication of the Code of Practice in March? How did you approach
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, with, as you would expect, there is a very rigorous set of arrangements to ensure that standards are complied with and that checks and balances are there. So if there was a reason to progress a request for authorisation in this kind of territory, it must first have filled criteria to ensure that it was proportionate, that it was lawful, and that it was necessary. And these aren't just throwaway terms, these are specific terms that are part of the kind of gatekeeping process to ensure that it's a legitimate authorisation. Once it's satisfied that in the eyes of the applicant, it then would have been subject to a series of further checks involving people that are trained and specifically deployed within the organisation to offer a view on that and offer their expertise. And that would have gone through up to and including a final authorisation. Clearly, the change that's come in as a consequence of the review that you highlight was a specific adjustment relating to protected organisations or professions, which in this case included journalists, and that was a significant shift in terms of practice. And on the back of that, and on the back of the inspector's report, we've put in further checks and balances to make sure that that kind of degree of rigour and scrutiny is at an even higher level.
Were these seven authorised by an independent officer, not involved in any inquiry?
Well, it depends on the level of the authorisation, and of course, the more significant the level of intrusion, the higher the level of authorisation required. At the lower levels, for something, for example, like a subscriber check, that was at a level that may, for the purposes of example, may sit at an inspector level, and previously that could have happened within a department that was applying. That has, however, now changed, and that cannot happen, so there will be no instance where a department or a unit can authorise activity relating to their own request.
And how much information have you got in relation to the four requests which relate to legacy forces, and what happened there?
Well, very little, but this was, effectively, it's national practice. There was very little latitude for individual forces to kind of have their own practices. It would have been a general approach that would be in line with what I'm describing. But the important element of this is that all of those have been looked at in terms of normal scrutiny arrangements on an annual basis and been found to be within the guidance at that time, and appropriate standards of assurance were associated with each of them.
And when this code of practice was published, what steps did Police Scotland take to familiarise themselves with them to review their practice?
Well, again, I think it's on public record that the pace that the guidance came into being was very aggressive, and as a consequence, there is no doubt that that did lead to a more pressured introduction of these guidelines, and as a consequence, perhaps has played a factor in the error that undoubtedly was subsequently made. That said, there was information. The senior responsible officer has a responsibility within their job description to ensure that they provide a kind of liaison function and play a role in ensuring that the guidance that is emanating from the Home Office is appropriately distributed within the force, so that people, again, are aware of the change prior to it coming into being. There is a trail that did take place. There was a circulation. Officers that needed to be aware of the change in the main were. I can say that, looking at it from my perspective, it's probably fair to say that perhaps it was not as robust a communication process as I might have hoped, and that is also a learning point that's been picked up as a consequence of the action, and as a result of that, the communication henceforth will be more robust and more structured. But that's not to say it didn't happen. It did happen prior to. It's just, from my perspective, it perhaps left us a little vulnerable in terms of completeness.
For the record, who was that senior officer charged with overseeing this?
The SRO. The SRO is Detective Superintendent Brenda Smith, and she's currently still in place.
Okay, I'll let some other members in.
Just to follow up, is you just actually what went out on the change of this code of practice. What actually went out to your officers, and how did it go out, and when?
It was a circulation in terms of information that came from the Home Office. It was, well, there are a few things. One was the guidance itself, but of course it's quite complicated language in its own right, so it was important, I think, that it was supported by explanatory kind of notes. There was a package that I believe was a PowerPoint-type briefing pack that came from the Home Office, and that was circulated to appropriate officers. There was training that was subsequently provided. However, that training was not made available until after the applications that are now highlighted by the inspector. So what I'm saying is the authorisation was taken prior to the kind of formal training had been provided. And this is, again, Sir Anthony May has made the point that the compressed timelines associated with the delivery of the guidelines did undoubtedly cause pressures. I know the Home Office were asked on more than one occasion for access to appropriate briefing materials, and it was very slow for us to get that information to then disseminate.
Do you have the timeline?
I would need to check the specific date that the email was sent. I don't have that in front of me.
I think it'd be useful to have the timeline, and then how it was circulated. Was there any response from officers and receiving? Because we've had evidence before that a plethora of emails went out to officers since Police Scotland, and it might have got buried in the, you know, 100. I don't know. I don't know how you highlighted this. It's a very significant change, so it's very important to know how it was imparted, when it was imparted, when the training took place, everything to do with the change in the process that's key to these five particular cases. That would be very helpful to the committee. John.
Thank you. Good morning, panel. Mr Richardson, IOCO undertook inspections in 2012 and 2013. Did they voice any criticisms then?
I don't have access to the finding. The important part was that the level of adherence with the guidance was at an acceptable level. Undoubtedly, with any inspection report, there's always commentary. There's always kind of areas for improvement, training issues, and I have no doubt that these reports would have included such material and guidance. But the critical part, from I guess an organisation's point of view, is that there were no particular concerns regarding compliance raised by the inspector.
Could you ensure that these reports are shared with the committee, please?
I need to check the availability of that, but I'm happy to have a look at that. And if it's possible to share, then I'm okay. Happy to do it.
What is the accredited list, Mr. Richardson?
Accredited list, sorry?
Mm-hmm. Connected with IOCA inspections or authorisation?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Does the term accredited list have any currency in what we're discussing that you're aware of?
I'm not sure. It's not familiar to me as a term. So, okay. I mean, there are people that are, they carry specific responsibilities. And I mentioned one of those, the SRO. If that's what you mean by an accredited list of people that have a key role in this, then I understand that. But I don't understand an accredited list as a term.
Okay. How many people who might have accreditation to do certain things have been removed, had that accreditation removed?
I would need to check that.
Again, could you share that with the committee then, please?
I'll endeavour to do so.
Thank you very much indeed. The June 2014 inspection was the first that was undertaken for the National Sea Counter Corruption Unit. What was the outcome of that?
Sorry, are you referring to the IOCO inspection?
Yes.
The IOCO inspection did not specifically just look at the CCU.
But with regard to the CCU, what was the outcome?
Well, I mean, again, in terms of the report findings, what it has determined is that there were five instances where the guidelines had not been followed. But this is an area that I think is crucially important. And if you'll forgive me, Chair, I think I would like to...
I'm a bit lost. I think you're talking about something earlier.
June 2014 was the first inspection carried out of the counter corruption.
Right. Sorry, I'm talking about the subsequent.
No, we were asked about the June 1, 2014.
Right, okay. Well, Forgive me, I need to check the detail of that.
So you wouldn't be aware that there was commentary about the poor record keeping, the poor form standards, and a comment that it was a manual system rather than an electronic system that was used.
Yeah, but, I mean, this has all been part of an ongoing change, and I've given evidence to this committee before in terms of the reform and, you know, the necessity to understand that things cannot change overnight, and there were plans in place to move to electronic processes that were in train and are now in place.
You are familiar with these criticisms, to Mr. Richardson?
Well, yeah, I'm aware as part of, I don't know the specifics. I can't recall those specifically, but they were part of a raft of information that led to us making the decisions to improve and make the adjustments within CC that we have. And there has been significant change in both the PSD and the CCU environment.
And was a finding that the CCU had committed multiple errors, some of them being the same mistakes repeated?
Well, again, you're referring to a document. I can't remember the detail of it. I wouldn't challenge if that information was there, then you're clearly cited on it better than me.
Would you have anticipated you might have been asked about that, given the subject matter?
Well, again, this is the kind of point that I think is important to raise. What has surfaced over a number of months now are a series of accusations and newspaper headlines that have built a picture which bears little resemblance to the facts or the reality of this. And I know there's a lot of commentary about the CCU and what they've done, and indeed up to and including me as some kind of archetypal villain that is playing fast and loose with the rules. The reality of this is very different, and if you'll allow me, Chair, just to kind of try and highlight actually what's happened here. At the base of the five cases that really are at the heart of all of this, they relate to...
I wonder, Mr. Richardson, I have a series of questions. They are fairly straightforward. A lot of them are actually indeed closed questions, yes or no.
To do with prior to this 2015 thing, are we still
yes,
in
indeed.
Historic?
Yes,
I'm not unhappy
yeah.
about
no,
that.
No.
I think John wants to go through the background, which was started by Roderick Campbell, and then we'll move on to the 2015. Yes,
yeah.
John.
I understand that these multiple errors were recorded as one error rather than multiples, because if it had been multiple recording, that would have looked bad. Is your awareness of that at all?
Again, you're quoting me details of a report that I don't have at the front of my mind.
So if also the suggestion that had uncovered blatant breaches of the new journalistic code, would you have knowledge of that?
So we're referring to the new code, which is the code that's now coming in March. Is that what you mean?
I'm actually referring, I thought, to 2014. If you're saying, are you aware of any findings other than the report giving rise to us being here that refer to shortcomings with regard to the treatment of journalists?
I'm not aware of specific breaches with regard to the guidelines as they relate to journalists. Prior to the AOCA report, no, I'm not.
Okay, you said there was a tight time frame. How much notice were you given of these changes?
Well, I mean, again, there's a timeline there that has been laid in. The report itself, or the guidance, should I say, was something that would, under normal circumstances, have involved considerable consultation, stakeholder engagement, and usually the part that enables people to become familiar with the spirit of the change and what actually the change means in application is linked to that consultation. And that's the part where Sir Anthony May has said himself that the time frame associated with that was not allowing the extensive consultation that would normally take place and enabled some of the provisions to be less clear than they should or would have ideally been. So again, I can forward the exact timelines in terms of when the consultation started and finished. I'm not saying there wasn't a timeline, I'm just saying it was rather shorter than we would have liked, and therefore we think it has had an impact on our ability to make sure that the officers involved in this authorisation process fully understand the implications of the guidelines.
Would that have included, Mr. Richardson, information from the College of Policing about the proposed changes?
More than likely, yes.
Are you able to see who Clark Cousin is?
Clark Cousin is the Detective Chief Superintendent who heads up the CCU.
So it would be helpful for us to hear from Mr. Cousin. He would have more specific knowledge
on these matters?
He, in probability, would have, yes.
Okay, just a couple of may I please. Did the force get downgraded by IOCO in any standing?
At this
point? At any point?
Not that I'm aware of. In terms of, I'm not sure what you mean by downgraded. Clearly, we either adhere to the guidelines and the principles or we don't. And again, the most recent inspection has indicated that there were five occasions where the guidelines were not properly met. So, is that a downgrade?
As, you're the disciplinary authority for Police Scotland, Mr. Richardson. Have you initiated any misconduct proceedings against anyone regarding anything that we're discussing today?
No, I haven't.
No. Are you the subject of any criminal or misconduct proceedings?
I'm not sure that I'm the person to be asking around that.
But you know the process is that if you were, you would be aware of that. So if you're not aware of it, presumably you're not.
Well, it's not always the case that I'm aware of complaints that are made. There's a due process that's gone through, and at some point in that process, I may be made aware. And so, you know, I don't want to mislead you here, but it's the authority that carries, the police authority that carry responsibility in terms of chief officer conduct matters, and I would think that that's a question that's perhaps better directed at the police authority.
Has police...
Mr. Foley.
Indeed, convener. The answer to that question would be yes, but not in connection with matters that we're discussing today.
Thank you. Mr. Richardson, finally, has Police Scotland used RIPA on any journalists in relation to identifying their sources?
Again, the important part here is that we are subjected to rigorous and detailed investigation and scrutiny by the appropriate...
It's one of these close questions. That's a yes or a no one.
It's never quite as simple as that when we're giving the answer. What has been highlighted is that in every instance where an authorisation has been sought, the inspector has confirmed that that is appropriate in lines with our obligations. There are five instances where that has not been the case. And again, they all relate to the same circumstances that, again, have led to me being asked to come along here today. So beyond that, I think what I'm trying to say to you is that that compliance is assured by a very detailed and rigorous inspection regime, and that is an ongoing process. So the public and yourselves should take confidence from that process that our compliance is at a very high level, and where errors are made, that is immediately acted upon and surfaced in a public way to enable the public to have confidence that these very important and sensitive areas of authorisation are appropriately discharged.
But as Deputy Chief Constable of Police Scotland, you have a responsibility for ensuring compliance, and you failed in that responsibility.
Well, I mean, I've never sought to defend a position. The inspector has given us a report following a detailed investigation indicating that there were five instances where the standard was not met. We accept that, we've acted on it, we've corrected it, and indeed the inspector has confirmed that he's very content that the actions that have been put into place are effective and appropriate, and I believe he said robust, and they will ensure that a similar failure cannot happen in the future. I think that that's my responsibility. I can't, clearly, I don't think anybody in Police Scotland can say categorically errors will never happen. It's important, though, when they do happen, that we act on it and try and make sure that they don't happen again.
Okay, thank you very much.
Is it relating to...
Point on the history, just...
All right. Elaine, you're...
The ICOCO report we were referring to earlier on, the one you weren't familiar with, dated February 2015. Are you able to say who in Police Scotland, if any, saw this report and who would have been charged with acting upon it?
The IOCA report dated February 2015.
Yeah, which was the precursor to the Code of Practice coming in.
Well, again, we have a range of people within the organisation that actively and on a day-to-day basis deal with that activity. So just because I'm saying I don't have specific... I've not read that detail prior to coming to here. Please don't infer from that that people in the organisation aren't aware of it. I can clarify that and I can come back to you.
Okay, thank you.
Elaine, to be followed by Alison.
Thank you, Convener. After the Commission reported to the Prime Minister in July, there were rumours, strong rumours, that Police Scotland was one of the two organisations which wasn't adhering to the Code of Practice and, in fact, was breaking the law. Can you advise what you did, both organisations? This is a question for the SPA as well as for Police Scotland. What did your organisation do when these allegations surfaced?
Well, sorry, John, do you want to?
Yeah, I'll, thank you. Yes, in relation to the allegation surfacing, the authority was first made aware roughly in mid-July. Certainly I was advised by the Chief Constable at that point in time it was happening, as was the former Chair was also advised by Police Scotland. At that point in time, had a view, and I think it was a correct view, that this was a statutory matter for IOCO, because they are the body which are who are responsible for investigating this type of activity. We decided to advise our authority members, which we did, and we subsequently awaited the report being prepared by IOCO, and then we invited Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary to carry out a review on behalf of the authority. That has been accepted. HMIC met with IOCO yesterday, I believe, and we will look to finalise terms of reference in relation to the review over the next week.
I'm a bit concerned about that. I mean, Police Scotland are accountable to the Scottish Police Authority, and I would have thought when a serious allegation was made that Police Scotland might have broken the law, that the SPA would have been a bit more proactive than that.
Yes, I understand your concern in relation to that. However, I must reiterate that IOCO are the body who have the statutory responsibility for such investigations, and we believe that it was necessary for us to allow IOCO to carry out their statutory duties and to prepare a report which the authority will look to have a subsequent review carried out by HMICS. We do not have investigatory powers.
Can I ask Police Scotland?
Did you call in anybody having notice of this, or did SPA just sit back in its hands and wait for others to deal with it?
Yes.
No. Indeed, prior to summer, authority members, one authority member in particular, had discussions with Police Scotland over some earlier publications from IOCO. I certainly had, as I say, a conversation first of all in mid-July with the Chief Constable, and subsequent conversations after that as the investigation was progressing. But we had to allow IOCO to carry out their statutory responsibilities.
And these were formal discussions with the Chief Constable, wasn't it? Minister discussions?
Well, they're not minuted, no, because my discussions with the Chief Constable took place on a regular basis every 3 or 4 weeks, so not formally recorded, no.
The first SPA knew that there was an allegation about Police Scotland?
Yes.
And the same for Police Scotland, that was the first you knew of it?
Yes.
Police Scotland the same? You hadn't heard any rumours of this before IOCO's report came out?
So, in essence, what has happened is the IOCO inspectors came in on the 15th of June and did their inspection. What happened as a consequence of that inspection is that there was obviously the usual kind of synthesis of what they had learned, and then they made us aware of potential breaches. Mm-hmm. At that point, Ian Livingston, the deputy chief with responsibility in kind of that area, and myself had a conversation, and that was on the 8th of July, where we specifically were advised of this potential series of breaches, and we initiated a specific piece of work to be done, and it was ACC Ruru Nicholson that we tasked to do that. That is the piece of work that generated an immediate action plan to act on the breaches and make changes to ensure that they could not be repeated. The action plan contained some 12 recommendations. 11 have been fully discharged, and the final one is in the process of being completed. And from that, there were then a series of cascade briefings. And as John highlights, on the 15th of July, the chair of the authority was fully briefed, as was the cabinet secretary.
This may be a difficult...
Yeah. Can we see the action plan?
I need to just confirm with colleagues if there's anything sensitive in that.
Well, it'd be very useful for the committee because that will tell us the things that were going wrong, presumably, if you've got an action plan now to remedy it.
Well, it's probably wrong to say the action plan will show you what's gone wrong, but what it will show you is a series of further enhancements to ensure that the bar is pushed to a higher level. So, you know, there's additional levels of checking that have been built into it. And as I say, it's a comprehensive action plan that's also been commented on by the inspector, and he has said that it's a very robust set of arrangements.
Was that inspection the 15th of June unannounced?
No.
So you knew they were coming. What notice did you have that IOCO inspector was coming?
I need to check the formal arrangements, but for ensuring that the appropriate people are available, etc., there's always a kind of a lead-in to that. It is fair to say that, again, contrary to some of the headlines, the breaches as they have come forward later were not breaches as have been described in terms of some kind of glaring omission. These were errors of interpretation, errors of judgment related to some extremely skilled members of staff that have undoubtedly made an error, but at least I'm not suggesting otherwise, but to give the inference, as I know some of the headlines have done, that this was a complete and utter kind of neglect of the rules that are set out is not an accurate description of what's happened.
It's still the case that IOCO said it was reckless.
There's an important context associated with that language. There is a necessity, which is again set out in the guidelines, that if there is adverse consequences for anybody because of the activity that's been authorised, it can be determined in one of only two ways. It can be termed as willful or it can be termed as reckless. The inspector was clear that there is no evidence to suggest any willful element to this, and therefore it only leaves the definition of reckless. Now, that is something that, for you and I, the word reckless is quite an extreme word, and for any member of the public that would read that, it does have a level of kind of concern, rightly, that would be associated with it. But it's important to understand that in the circumstances here, reckless is effectively defined by something that has failed to be done or has not happened, and it was the only consequence that could be reached or the only term that could be used other than willful. Now, I think that's really important for people to understand because, again, the general intuitive understanding of reckless is more extreme.
How did you come to that definition? Where's this definition that you've given us for reckless? Where's that come from?
Well, again, there is no set definition.
Yes, you're right. And I'm sorry, an omission is a different thing from something that's reckless. I think the inspector would very carefully choose their words. Anyway,
I'm giving a particular...
It's your definition.
Given the case that this refers to, where an investigation into a murder had not been properly undertaken and the inquiries were around who had spoken to the journalist, surely that's willful rather than reckless.
The inspector is the person who has gone through the detail of the evidence. They have determined very clearly there is no willful element to this, and they have defined it as reckless. And in the discussions that have taken place, it is clear within that there is whilst there's no set definition, there is an interpretation that's been placed on that by the inspector to help us understand what he means by reckless. But that's information that is not in the public domain, and therefore it leaves us in a difficult position.
Sorry, the inspector's given you a definition of reckless that's not in the public domain. I heard you properly there.
There is a document that I am in receipt of is not in the public domain gives more clarity on that.
Well, it would be very useful to the committee. It would give us more clarity too to see that document.
It would, unfortunately. I'm not in a position to share that.
Who is in a position to share it?
It would need to be the source, which is IOCO.
Just finally,
Has IOCO said on that document that it's for your eyes and your eyes only?
It contains information that would potentially compromise subsequent proceedings, and as a result, it would be inappropriate to have that in the public domain.
I'm a bit lost here. Subsequent proceedings, what are we talking about?
There may be, as I said, in terms of the process, the inspector has determined that some individuals have been adversely affected as a result of the authorisations.
But there are no live proceedings just now. There's nothing that's sub judice.
No, but there's another stage of a process that might very well be taking place, which is an IPT, and therefore we need to be cautious that we don't compromise that.
I think we wish to press you on this, because as you've given us a definition of reckless that the IOCO has shared with you but is not being shared with us, I don't think we'd be doing our duty to the public and to this Parliament not to see that document one way or another. So I think when we come later to discuss this, the committee may very well want to decide how to proceed with that. Sorry.
I failed to understand how the definition of a word could be sub judice or couldn't be released to the general public. I mean, surely dictionaries provide definitions of words. There's a definition of reckless, which isn't like the current understanding of the term of the word. I don't really see how that can be very difficult to release that. But just finally, when did you yourselves become, you said that the Home Office was slow in releasing information about the changes in requirements. When did you both become aware that there was a change in the requirements, and what degree of responsibility did you think you had to ensure that that was complied with?
Again, just to rehearse what I said previously, I mean, there are arrangements in place within Police Scotland to ensure that not just this, but any change in operating arrangements, the law or policy and practice are appropriately communicated, and where there's implications through training or anything else, they are managed. In our case, that is the SRO's responsibility, and the SRO has indeed done exactly that. Whether, you know, I'm saying that the Home Office was slow, I think that is a consequence of the compressed timeline that the guidelines were drawn up and then implemented. I'm quite certain that the Home Office was under pressure to develop these guidelines. It's just a consequence of the whole picture.
Can I just ask, where we move to Alison, have the SPA, have you seen this document that defines reckless and so on?
Convener, no, we haven't seen the document. Our understanding of the legislation, and we've had this confirmed by the Commissioner, is that the Commissioner deals solely with Chief Constables. That's where the relationship lies throughout the UK. So, therefore, we will seek assurance from the incoming Chief Constable, Philip Gormley, that the SPA will have sight of that document once he is in post, and we will review it at that point in time. Clearly, we have asked HMI CS to carry out a review as well, but we will be making our own determinations once we have sight of the document. The Commissioner is not in a position to share it with the authority.
HMICS, then, they must have getting sight of this so-called document that defines reckless if they're doing an inspection. Is that correct?
I would imagine, yes, indeed.
So you're sharing it with other people. You're sharing it with the SP eventually and HMICS. I cannot see why it's going to be shared with the Parliamentary Committee. So we'll pursue this. Alison, please.
Thank you. I mean, the terms willful and reckless are there because breaches of privacy in this kind of area are so significant. And, you know, I understand that Mr. Richardson's desire to minimise the damage of the language, but the language is there because, as I say, these are significant breaches. Can I return to what the SPA said? You said that you did nothing for 4 months after you learned in mid-July that there were these concerns. You, in your conversations with the Chief Constable, you didn't discuss what arrangements were being put in place to prevent further breaches for those 4 months?
No, that's not quite accurate. We did actually, one of the authority members raised the matter at our August board meeting with the Chief Constable and asked for comment, but as it was subject of the ongoing investigation, that the response was almost that. It was subject to investigation and would be reported back in due course.
Yes, would it not have been appropriate for yourself or the board members to say, well, let's set aside that particular investigation, but this raises general issues for for Police Scotland, what are you doing with that?
Yes, well, given that this was the first time that we had encountered this situation, we had to get a determination of exactly what our powers were in relation to it and the powers of the Commissioner. And we took a decision that, based on that, that we would wait upon the Commissioner's investigation and the findings. And at that point in time, regardless of the outcome, we would look to ask HMICS to carry out a review, and also that we would look to have a copy of the report where we could make our own determinations upon. The legislation would appear to suggest, as I said earlier, that the Commissioner deals solely with Chief Constables. It is then up to the Chief Constable to determine whether he or she releases that information to an authority or a Commissioner. We don't envisage, I personally wouldn't envisage a Chief Constable or Chief Constable saying, no, we're not going to share it with you. But if that were to be the case, then we would have to look at that in a different light.
Mr. Richardson, you said in response to Mr. Finney that there were no officers from Police Scotland's counter-corruption unit going through misconduct proceedings as a result of breaching this code. Is that correct?
There's at this stage, that's correct.
Yeah. Short of that, what have you done in terms of trying to establish why these breaches occurred in this particular instance? Because you said all five related to one case?
Yes.
Can you tell us what you did short of misconduct proceedings?
Well, again, the context of this is critically important, and if you'll allow me. Basically, what we're dealing with here is information that has breached out of a live murder inquiry. That is very concerning and potentially was compromising the flow of justice and potentially would compromise that murder inquiry. As a result of that, it would have been a neglect of duty had we not taken steps to try and do something about that. That information was first identified and surfaced by officers involved in the murder inquiry, and they referred that to the CCU. The CCU were effectively asked to do a piece of work to try and determine the problem and whether or not somebody within the murder inquiry had in fact broken the law. That's in line with CCU responsibilities. That's kind of how they operate and that's what they do. They, as part of that investigation, proposed a course of action that included the authorisations that now are subject to the concerns. But they did not self-direct that, but instead passed that authorisation out with, again, to another part of the business, to go through the appropriate checking process associated with the guidelines and appropriate authorisation. The officer, certainly at the kind of more significant level of authorisation, did a significant piece of work and tried to apply the new regulations as he understood them. He's a very experienced officer that's been involved in this business for more than a decade, has also signed off on more than 2,500 authorisations in various ways, and is part of a department that has been commended for the last 2 years by the Office of Surveillance Commissioners during the annual inspections. So this is an extremely experienced officer that tried his level best to apply the regulations and what was required of him, and in so doing, misinterpreted the requirement and allowed the authorisations to go ahead, which then subsequently was identified by the inspectors as being wrong. That is the reality of what's happened here. The CCU were effectively people that were simply trying to take forward a requirement that came from another part of the business and was authorised in another part of the business. So the kind of notion that the CCU are running amok here, doing inappropriate action, just simply isn't accurate.
Well, I've not made any suggestion that anybody is running amok. Can you tell us the rank and the position of the person who signed off the authorisations?
Well, there were five authorisations, and three of them, they were asking for different types of activity. The more significant parts of the activity were signed off by a detective superintendent, and that's the individual I'm referring to just now. The two of the kind of lesser or lower significance authorisations were signed off by a detective inspector.
And you said earlier, you said that the checks and balances and the sign-offs were out with the CCU, but the findings were that two of them were within the organisation.
So that process is part of the action plan that's now changed, but for the lower two that were signed off by the detective inspector, that's correct. That was a detective inspector that was within the CCU. But again, I would stress that that was a practice that was acceptable, had previously been looked at by the inspectors, and there were no issues raised with that. What we have now done, though, in relation to this inspection, is raised the bar and basically made it more significant by ensuring that there is now no possibility that there can be any internal authorisations. They will now all be independent and external.
So you've said that this was about a murder case.
Yeah.
It would have then been of some significance and some concern within senior members of the organisation, surely, that you perhaps had someone who was leaking information. Is that right?
Correct.
Yeah. So who within the senior management of police knew about this, and why were you not extra careful about the sign-offs for this, given that it was such an important case?
Well, the suggestion that we've not been careful is not accurate. What I've described to you is a very rigorous and robust set of arrangements, and they were applied in this instance. It just so happens that the officer concerned has misinterpreted brand new legislation that at the point he was asked to do this was 22 days old, and there had been only a very rapid introduction with limited opportunity for training. And he himself had had documentation to read, but had not received the actual training course associated with the new guidelines and the change. So again, I don't seem to minimise this. A mistake was made, but the context of the mistake is really important. This is an officer that was trying his best to do his professional duty and has made an error of judgment.
Well, I think you do seek to minimise it, but you know, we have to rely on what the Commissioner has said, which was that it was not proportionate, it was not lawful, not necessary, and it was therefore reckless. That's what the ruling concluded. If your officer was aware that there was new guidelines, but he was not completely au fait with them, would you not have expected him to perhaps pause and consider that, particularly given that it was relating to journalist sources?
Well, what I am suggesting to you, and I have taken time to speak to the individual concerned, and I've read all the associated documentation, I am comfortable that he did take a pause. He did try and do his level best to ensure that the guidelines and the change had been applied. He did and has a considerable background and credibility with authorisation activity that's been recognised, as I've said, on two successive years by the OSC. This is not an officer that has simply thrown caution to the wind and neglected his duties. Nothing could be further from the truth. But what he has done, he's made a misjudgment with regard to 22-day-old legislation that's led to the inspector's finding that he's authorised activity that should not have been authorised in that way.
The detectives. This is the detective superintendent, is it?
Yes.
What's his name again? Is that
David Donaldson?
David Donaldson.
Okay. You've made quite a lot of the fact that the legislation was new, and the new guidelines were new. It was very high profile though, because it resulted from concerns about accessing journalist sources. So there was a lot of public awareness of the new guidelines, and it was obviously Westminster legislation. So I'm surprised again that Police Scotland didn't manage to implement this thoroughly when many other police forces did. Can I turn to...
Listen, one of the things was Detective Superintendent Donaldson in any way involved in this murder inquiry?
No.
So he's completely independent of it. Thank you.
Well, perhaps just a final point on that. Did I've forgotten his name. Donaldson.
Yes.
Did Donaldson seek advice from senior officers, from his senior officers? Or did he make the ruling on his own without any further?
I would need to clarify that specific point, although in normal course... these are the force experts. These are the people who would advise senior officers. The area of technical expertise associated with this entire area of business is extremely high. It's technical, it's complicated, and the stakes are extremely high. And, you know, that's the reason that we treat it so seriously and that there are such a high level of checks and balances put in here. And that's why I just simply can't accept your point with regard to the kind of what is implied as a neglect here in relation to practice. It's not. What's happened here is a misinterpretation of new legislation.
Well, the checks and balances clearly didn't work. The law was breached because judicial approval wasn't sought, obviously. Has Police Scotland sought judicial approval for any other applications relating to journalism since the new rules came in March?
No.
No. Okay, thank you.
Margaret Mitchell, please, Margaret.
Just to press you a little bit on that point, ACC Richardson, it says in the IOCC report the two applications had been approved by the designated person that was not independent of the investigation. Isn't there a conflict of interest then, Tess, that is always applied with any internal investigation or any investigation indeed?
Well, again, I come back to, we have now changed that and we've introduced a level of complete independence, but prior to that, that was accepted practice. That was how the business was conducted. It was inspected and found to be acceptable by those that regulate us. So, and that won't be unique to Police Scotland, that will be across the UK. So again, we have now, on the back of this learning experience, pushed the bar yet higher again, and hopefully that will ensure, you know, a higher level of comfort in that particular area. But prior to that, it was the way the business was done. And again, in terms of that level of authorisation, we are talking about a subscriber check. You know, this is not...
Just explain what that is exactly, please, a subscriber check.
So if we have, for the sake of argument, somebody within Police Scotland that has a mobile telephone, and we know that that telephone has contacted a number of telephone numbers, a subscriber check would be to say, from this telephone number, who does that belong to? That is a subscriber check. That's effectively the authorisation, the two authorisations that we're referring to here. It's exactly that. It's trying to identify from a known number who owns that number.
Well, if anything, I think that just fills me with more apprehension, because it seems to me in any organisation, and especially if it's internally that you're looking at investigating something, right up there at the very top of that investigation should be, is there any possible conflict of interest? And I would have thought that was just good practice before we're looking at smoking mirrors about 22-day-old new code of practice guidelines that somehow someone couldn't interpret. Isn't that a fair comment?
Well, again, this, I come back to my point. This was the practice. That's the way the business was conducted, and it's now changed.
Right, well, I think that explains
back
a lot.
A minute, Margaret. This is the detective inspector level,
yeah.
Right, when it was, you call it lower level subscriber. Were they involved in any way in the case, in this murder case?
Not in the murder case, no.
They weren't involved in this fight. So how can the IOCC say that there was a conflict of interest? Where does that come into this?
So again,
Or investigating officers connected to this case. They weren't at all.
The DIs that permitted
subscriber checks. They weren't in any way connected to this reopened investigation into the murder.
What I described is that we have a category A murder, live murder case.
Yes.
And in the progress of that, officers involved in that inquiry identify that a potential breach has taken place where information that should have been contained within that environment had been made available out with. They then raise that and refer it to a separate part of the business, which is the CCU, which is there effectively to take care of a range of things, included in this particular instance, internal investigations of criminality. They were charged with that and were progressing that inquiry to try and find out where this breach within the murder team had taken place. And the DI, that is the person that we're talking about just now, was part of that CCU activity.
Ah, and can we have that person's name, in fairness to having had D.S. Donaldson's? Who was that?
Julie, I've forgotten her surname. It's Joe forgive me, I'll come back to you on that.
Thank you very much, Margaretson.
Perhaps if we could go back to the necessity and proportionate statutory test. Why was it thought it was necessary and proportionate?
Sorry.
That's been found to be contravened. It's been found to be contravened to the extent it's been termed reckless, albeit under your definition. Why was it thought that it was proportionate and necessary?
So, in essence, the issue relates to the information connected to a journalist. And the breach, it was understood in the circumstances, the breach has happened within a murder inquiry, presumably emanating from a serving police officer. The operating view was that that information had been provided to somebody on the outside of the organisation who was in fact a retired police officer. And at some stage, subsequent to that, it clearly has been given to a journalist at some stage because the information ended up in the newspapers. The focus initially of the consideration was that it was not intended to look at a journalist or try and identify a journalist. It was focused around trying to find out who had breached their responsibilities within the murder team. And again, that focus was quite narrow. The guidelines, as they have subsequently been identified by the inspector, has indicated that actually, if it subsequently became a journalist source at whatever stage, that must be considered and therefore taken into account. And that's the fundamental difference. So if in terms of proportionality and necessity, that was considered and looked at and deemed to be at the right level, but it was taken too narrow a consideration of ultimately when it became the information of a journalist, and as a consequence, that's what the inspector has highlighted, and therefore led to the inevitable conclusion that it was either willful or reckless, and it was not willful, therefore it had to be reckless.
In other words, it was a breach of Article 10, which is the freedom of expression, because you weren't just focusing on this person that had leaked the information. All consideration of who else this might be affecting was not taken into account.
Well, that's ultimately the substance of the new regulation. So Article 8 and Article 10 are core considerations. And ultimately, the new guidelines indicate that protected professions need to be far closer to the front of our thinking. And again, that's where the misjudgment has taken place.
Yeah, because in your evidence today, when we've been asking quite reasonable questions, you've continually referred to newspaper headings, and it seems to me that there's quite a lot of resentment from you to some of these newspaper headings. Did that cloud the judgment, therefore, that Article 10 was breached, freedom of expression?
No, what I'm trying to explain is a context. So we've had...
I understand all that. I have the context. And what was overlooked was Article 10, the fact that it would involve perhaps looking and identifying a journalist when you were focusing quite clearly on this individual who had leaked some information. You didn't take into account the effect it might have on the freedom of expression under Article 10 affecting journalists. And I ask you that because on a number of occasions today, you've, if you like, had a go at the press.
No, what I'm trying to suggest is that the journalistic element was separate in the initial thinking and consideration, not separate, but it was so far removed or distant that the consideration was in a different place. That has subsequently been found to be not correct, and therefore changes have taken place to ensure that that doesn't happen again. I'm not suggesting that somehow we have neglected or been driven by concerns about headlines. What I am trying to simply say is that as this has played out, there's been a continued series of headlines that have happened at a time where, because the investigation was still ongoing, we've not been in a position to provide any context or commentary to that, which in a sense has kind of fueled the concern and led to a position where I'm quite sure the public are being led to believe that there's levels of activity associated with this that haven't actually happened.
I think we've got all that, EC Richardson, but it seems to me, and I'm only coming to this now, you know, looking at these papers, then if I were looking at these papers and being asked to implement it, two things would be crystal clear to me. One, I've got to look at the source that I'm seeking the information about, and two, I've got to look at the possible collateral damage, i.e. who else would be affected by this that we didn't intend to pursue. And it seems to me that there was obviously there was a willful neglect or a huge neglect of that, be it reckless, if not willful. I think that concludes my question.
I'm going to take Margaret McDougall next, who's not been in, and I've got my glasses on. Then I've got Gil, then John, then Rod.
I'd like to come back.
Sorry? Beg your pardon? Oh, I beg your pardon. I will take you after Margaret. I didn't know. You're not on my list, but we're slipping up here a little. Right, Margaret.
Thank you, and good morning. Who has responsibility within Police Scotland for ensuring that the designated persons referred to in the Commissioner's report were made aware of the new code of practice and the requirement to seek judicial approval? Well, so who's responsible for that?
The SRO that I've mentioned previously, the senior responsible officer, Brenda Smith, the detective superintendent, who is the liaison point and acts as a conduit with the Home Office for information.
So did Detective Superintendent Donaldson seek advice from the SRO?
There would have been communication there because the SRO is the one that's forwarded it. I've said previously I would need to check with David Donaldson to find out exactly who he spoke to, but I wouldn't expect he is the person who is the force expert. Mm-hmm. He is the person that would effectively advise others. So he, I would be expecting to read the guidance, the legislation, and be able to, using his experience, determine exactly what that means in terms of practice.
Yeah. So just for my sake, because I'm not into all the technical jargon, judicial approval, what does that mean?
It means it has to be looked at and considered by a judge.
Mm. So is that not clear in the code of practice then?
I'm not sure I understand. The code of practice that's...
The code of practice says that it requires judicial approval.
Yes, but what I've explained is that what has happened here in terms of these five breaches is that active and fulsome consideration was given. The line that was taken by the officer formed a view that this did not involve journalists, or it was so far removed that it didn't require the judicial approval as set out in the guidelines, and as a consequence, he felt... now erroneously, that it was acceptable for him to authorise the activity without that step being taken. The inspector's report have highlighted that that was an error of judgment. He should have considered it as being a journalistic source, and therefore it should have gone through the process to ask for and seek judicial approval. So that is exactly the heart of the issue.
Yeah, so as I said, as a layperson... It seems clear to me that journalists, you were saying, you know, this intercepted communication between, you presumed, a member of the police force with a journalist. But that wasn't clear to this detective.
It wasn't. The focus, as I've
Donaldson.
Said previously, was that there was a breach from a murder inquiry involving a police officer to a retired police officer. And the focus was on the serving officer within the murder squad. So the journalist was further down the stream. And therefore, the initial consideration it formed the view that it therefore didn't apply, that we required judicial approval. Now, again, that's subsequently been highlighted as being incorrect. But at the time, That was a judgment that was reached by an experienced individual that did his best to apply the changed legislation to the circumstances presented and formed a view.
Okay. So the fact that this information finished up in the papers means it must have got to a journalist. That didn't occur to this detective superintendent.
Well, clearly not. I mean, that's something that is now being taken account of, and the inspector has said that that's something that does need to be taken account of, and we've taken the necessary steps.
Yeah. So what training then was given to this detective superintendent, Donaldson? He had no training. He only had the legislation in front of him, which to me, I think, quite clearly says judicial approval is required. But he didn't pick up that actually the fact it was in the papers, there was no journalists involved. He didn't pick that up.
Are you referring to what training he's had specifically around the guidelines or in general?
Yeah, on the code of practice.
So
yeah.
In the code
You're
of practice.
You're an expert. He's an expert.
Yeah, so as I mentioned before, he did receive training, but that was after this authorisation was sought and taken. Prior to that, he'd received the guidelines, as I highlighted earlier on, that came via the SRO that was available. It was written documentation, there was a presentation, he had to interpret that, which he did, to try and inform his decision-making process. And on this occasion, he has misjudged that.
I'll just leave it there.
Christian. Sorry, Christian.
Thanks very much. Good morning, gentlemen. First of all, I would like to go back to the timeline. And I would like to check with you what you just said, in fact. It's you said that the change in the law was enacted on the 25th of March. And 22 days later, the CCU made the request. Now, between this period of time and the 15th of June, you said repeatedly, and you just said, that the person in charge received later on some training. So alarm bell must have been ringing at that point, that what has been done was not compared to the new legislation, in front of the new legislation, was not permissible. What happened between that time that he got the clarification and the training that what he had just done was not lawful, what happened between that time and the time the IOCOCO started the investigation?
Well, as I say, there was active consideration by this officer, and he was content at that time and subsequently that his judgment was accurate. The training didn't adjust that position, and it was when the inspection took place on the 15th of June that they picked up on these authorisations, and then of course there was subsequent conversation. But up until that point, the authorising officer was comfortable that his decision was appropriate.
But, you know, then it's wrong. It has to be wrong, because you said early on that he could have not known when he took that action because he didn't receive proper training. That training arrived and was there before IOCOCO became involved. Therefore, he should have realized his mistake. If he had not received a mistake, the point of him having training before or after he took the decision is pointless.
Again, this is not a straightforward issue, and it is hugely technical. And effectively, what Sir Anthony May has conceded is that the guidance that came out, even within the training, could have been clearer. And as a consequence, in terms of the considerations, notwithstanding the training, the detective superintendent that we're talking about here had applied a rationale and an approach to his decision making which he believed to be in line with the guidance and correct. That's a different view from the inspectors, and again, it's a view we now accept, and we've taken action accordingly. But at the time, this officer was trying to do his level best to live within the changes and the law and do his job. It's just subsequently been determined that that clearly was not correct.
So even when you received appropriate training and all the guidance which was available, which you asked for it to be available before when you took that decision, you think that it's quite logical that he still thought not to flag it up?
What I'm saying to you is that he was trying to do his job and he was applying an approach which he thought was correct. So with hindsight looking back, to try and sort of suggest that he should have known things, I don't think that that's appropriate.
I'm just trying to say how much guidance and how much do you need, and how much training does one need to understand that a mistake has been done?
Well, as ever, reading a direction, particularly in matters of law that are at times incredibly complicated, is not enough. And actually, what has been acknowledged through by all parties here is that it's through the engagement and the consultation that takes place normally on the lead-up to the change that people understand and have an opportunity to engage and test their thinking. And that, on this occasion, for various reasons and time pressures, has not happened to the extent that it should have done. That's led to a position where people are not as familiar with the spirit of the regulations as or the guidance as they perhaps should have been. But again, I'm rehearsing the same.
I know, but we're trying to understand when did this inspector got the training available to him would have been available before June. So there'll be at least a month or 2 months for him to justify what he had done. And because you said that earlier, you said that the timeline was too short for inspectors to understand what was required by this legislation. But you didn't give us a timeline. Why do you think it's long enough?
Christian, I've asked for that in detail. I've asked for a timeline in detail.
What I would like to know, what do you think it's long enough before the time of the enaction of legislation for train to take place, for you to be confident that inspectors will have time to take on that legislation on board? Is it a matter of month, a matter of year?
Well, I mean, it's impossible to answer a question like that. Ultimately, okay, what it needs to take place is appropriate consultation to give people an opportunity to engage. What's happened here is a training course was provided and the detective superintendent that we're talking about here received it on the 6th of May. The 6th of May is some considerable time after this guidelines have been in place, and indeed after a point where he's been asked to take a decision on authorities. That's clearly not a satisfactory situation.
So do you think between the 6th of May or the 15th of June, it's not long enough for him to flag it up to yourself?
So that's not a question about training. That.
I think we'll move on if you don't mind, Christian.
If I can keep going, if you don't
mind.
Well,
let's hear what it is first. Yes, please.
Yeah. I would like to come back into, we talked about training. I would like to go back to a letter that has been sent to you, Mr. Foley, from Mr. Anwar. I wanted to know if you wanted to make any comments on that, what we are discussing this morning.
I have been in receipt of a letter from Mr. Anwar, I don't feel it would be appropriate to discuss it this morning. It's a legal situation. Mr. Anwar is a solicitor.
So you received that letter? Does Mr.
Yes.
We've got the letter too. So
we've got the letter as well.
Quite happy for you. We know what it's at. We've got it as well. So.
Yeah. Clearly, Mr. Anwar is representing clients, and I will be considering Mr. Anwar's letter. I have yet to respond to him, so I will need to review the contents of his letter, carry out a review, and then respond to Mr. Anwar. I don't believe it would be appropriate to comment at the committee prior to having formulated a reply to Mr. Anwar.
Just remind members, we've not replied yet. We've yet to discuss what we're going to do with that letter.
So a last question, if I may.
You're holding back Gilbert. It's not my problem. You're sitting next to him.
You said early on that you thought that leak, this reopening of this murder inquiry, that leak from one of the officers to a journalist could be a breach of the law, so should be investigated. Do you think that the new arrangements, the change of legislation, will stop Police Scotland to do this kind of investigation?
No, I mean, we would be duty bound to investigate any serious criminality. And if we believe that a crime is taking place, then we will investigate that. The issue in relation to the guidelines is the manner in which, and the seniority, I suppose, in terms of authorities. So there is nothing in the guidelines that dictate that we cannot now take the necessary steps to investigate anything that requires to be investigated. We just have to go through further checks and balances to make sure that it is completely compliant and in line with the law.
Do you think that if you had asked for a request for it to happen, it would have been approved?
Let's move on, I think. I'm going to move on, Christian Gill.
Yes.
Followed by, now, I've got John and Rod and Les, and I know you, but we're itching to ask short supplementaries, those who've been in. But Gill, this is your first time.
Mine's are going to be supplementaries because most of the stuff
okay.
I thought my good friend, and I was elbowing him.
Elbow him in French next time.
I was just wondering who or what was pushing the timeline. Who was responsible for that? Was it the actual, because it was in legislation now, or was something other pressure on you to get things going?
I also don't know the answer to that. It's a reserved matter. There will have been a series of pressures, but I'm not in a position
But you said it was, I think matters were being rushed. Could is there a way that Police Scotland could have asked for more time so that training could take place, or is it because it's now in legislation that was what's pushing you to rush on?
No, I don't think Police Scotland could have done anything to adjust that general position. This is national change that takes place. Police Scotland were asking questions about information to enable training to take place, etc. But again, I'm not criticising. I know a number of colleagues, including those from the Home Office, were under pressure here. So nobody was being deliberately obstructive. It was just rather pressured for all concerned. And I think that's a position that's been well recognised by the various parties, including Sir Anthony May.
That notion of pressure, does that come with hindsight because of what's happened, or was the envelope too short? That's the point.
I think it's fairly clear looking at it now, and it's more stark when you look at it with hindsight, that to receive a training course several weeks after the guidelines have been implemented is far from ideal. The ideal course would be to ensure that an appropriate lead-in took place, that individuals were trained and ready to kind of properly apply the guidelines prior to it going live. But I suppose we don't live in an ideal world, and that certainly hasn't happened here.
Okay. And the fact that if that time had been available, I know that you said it is very, very complicated. Could it possibly still have happened, do you think, because of the complications, or was that too much to ask you to answer?
I mean, could it still have happened? Yes, it could have done. The reality here is it's about interpretation and application. Mm. And the officer concerned has never sought to, suggest that he... to avoid the criticism, he's effectively acknowledged that this was an error on his part, without rehearsing what I've said already, it's an officer that I believe was trying his level best to do his job and apply the regulations. He's just made a mistake.
And my last point is, you may have actually said this, but I don't know if it was. I don't know if I understood the answer quite correctly. When did Police Scotland take remedial action? When did you take that?
So after the inspection left, there was a period for them to kind of pull together the report, and we were advised on and around the 8th of July, and it was on that day that Ian Livingston and I had a conversation, and we tasked Rory Nicholson with a piece of work which led to 12 recommendations being made and some immediate measures to ensure that, well, there was a separation, that there was a Deputy Chief Constable that would be involved in the process around Article 8 and 10 and a number of others. And as I said, of those 12, 11 are now fully discharged and one relating to the judicial process is currently underway.
Okay, thanks very much.
Short ones, John, are they? Thank you.
Mr. Richardson, you were aware of the publicity. You were concerned it would compromise a live murder inquiry. What did you do
with regard to the publicity?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there was a series of requests coming in to make comment on the circumstances, and we were unable to make comment on the circumstances, largely because the inspection report had not been published. There was a half-yearly report that came
out. The publicity about the conduct of a live murder inquiry, you said earlier, that concerned you.
Yes.
What did you do about it?
Well, as I say, there was a there was a referral from the murder team to CCU, and there were...
Did you speak to the murder team?
No. I wouldn't routinely do that. We have mechanisms within the organisation. Ian Livingston and I had a conversation about the circumstances, but again, the CCU were charged with a piece of work to try and find out what the issues were.
Did you speak to the CCU?
Well, I speak to the CCU regularly. They work under my...
Mr. Richardson, I'm trying to establish... I mean, is it your position that whilst being aware of this, this was left to a DI to initiate all of this that results in us having this discussion today? Or did you have personal, direct knowledge of what was happening as a result of that publicity and the action that some of your subordinates took?
I clearly had awareness of what was happening here. So, and we have checks and balances and mechanisms within the organisation, which I'm describing to you, to ensure that rules are followed and processes are followed. They were initiated. And so, you know, if I was to jump in, that would present risk in its own right. So I have not done that in this instance.
So what were you aware of, though?
At what point? What do you mean? Man, I read the headlines as everybody else.
Yes, and clearly they concerned you, but I hope, like everyone else, you'll see there's an important role for the press in any liberal democracy to scrutinise. Our job is to scrutinise and understand what you did. You were aware the DI raised this issue?
So I don't understand the question. The DI raised which issue?
The issue of seeking to establish the source of this information.
So?
You were concerned about publicity. You've told us you were concerned about publicity and how that may impact on a live murder inquiry.
Yes.
And you say you have oversight, but you are saying that you didn't have direct involvement and how that was responded to by Police Scotland. Is that your position?
What I'm suggesting to you is that on a day-to-day basis, the CCU carry responsibility for a national organisation and have a range of investigations that are being conducted. I do not get into the detail of each of these investigations on a day-to-day basis. That's what I've got a Detective Chief Superintendent heading the unit to do, and I will receive updates in accordance with practice, and if there are any issues that need to be brought to my attention, they are.
So when did you receive an update on that publicity?
Well, we receive updates on the publicity on a day-to-day basis relating to the media coverage. Mm-hmm. I meet with the CCU usually about twice a week. There would have been routine reporting, but I can't give you a specific date in relation to...
Roughly, when would you have heard of how Police Scotland were responding to that publicity?
Well, Police Scotland were not responding to publicity because largely we were not in a position to do so.
I mean responding and seeking to establish the sources.
Well, that's an entirely separate thing.
Well, I don't know if I'm not making myself clear here.
I think what we're trying to get at is, here's newspapers running stories that a murder case has been mishandled and that there's almost, quotes, a cover-up. And you see things in the paper. And this isn't just any old thing that's happened that's been brought to light in the paper and the headlines. A high-profile murder case, mishandling of it, bit of a cover-up about not having handled the investigation properly and something. This is all going on. And then you find that surely you're going, who the hell's putting this to the papers? Let's find out. So what did you do? I mean, no. You know, I would imagine the top of the tree was shaking at the time to find out. And I think that's what your point is, John, isn't it? What did you do when you saw this? Who did you speak to, you know, in order to see where's this all coming from?
So there are two separate things here, and I think the distinction is important. There is general coverage in relation to murder inquiry. The Lord Advocate...
No, this is this case, this particular case.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. So ultimately, the bit that was the focus in relation to the referral to the CCU and then that subsequent inquiry related not to the generalities of the murder investigation and all of that associated activity, it related to a specific concern, the information
yes.
had breached from the murder team
yes.
Out with the confines of Police Scotland.
Yes.
Well, Mr. Richardson, let me stop you there. When did you become aware of that, please? And if it means you have to go and consult notes and come back to us, we would understand that because you're clearly a busy man. But when did you become aware of that?
Well, I'll refer back and identify from a timeline and include it in the follow-up correspondence that you're looking for.
You can understand, as a police officer, why that's important. It's when you have personal knowledge of the events giving rise to us being here.
And what you did following that, if anything.
Okay. I'll come back to you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can I just, one final point then. Is it your position then, Mr. or Richardson, is criticism of any live inquiry going to be seen always as compromising the inquiry, or is there a role for the press in articulating public concerns about a police inquiry?
Again, I draw a distinction between the two. The press are clearly entitled and have a role to play around making the public aware on a whole range of things, including a degree of kind of scrutiny over public bodies. That's absolutely appropriate and acceptable. The bit that my focus would be on is if individuals within Police Scotland have broken the law and have breached their responsibilities as serving officers. That is something I would expect the public would demand that we do address, and that's the focus here as far as the CCU inquiry is concerned.
Yes, absolutely. I could not agree with you more. You'll therefore understand my astonishment that the person charged with discipline in the force, the Deputy Chief Constable for Discipline, is unable to tell us how he responded to this matter, which caused him great concern. So, whilst I welcome you coming back with your notes, I would have thought you would have said, I was aware the DI did this, the CCU did that, I became aware of that, and this is where it went.
But
rather than
a
lecture yet again in process. This isn't about process, this is about your personal knowledge of it as the individual in charge.
Yeah, but I've answered a series of questions which maybe I'm just not understanding the question, Chair. I've given you a candid overview of my appreciation of this and how it's come to light. You're asking me questions now that I'm perhaps just not reading, but I think I've answered all of that.
Well, let me rephrase this another way. There's publicity that's something that could constitute a crime or could constitute misconduct. As the disciplinary authority, are you not proactive on that? Or are you just waiting to see how things unfold? Because the public's anticipation would be, you've gone, there's something wrong here. I need to find out what's happening. And I appreciate you've these various subordinates that will come to you with information. But it's inconceivable that you have no involvement in this until we get away down the line where someone analyses how you've gone about your processes and referred to it as being reckless.
No, if let's separate the media coverage entirely from this. What I've said is that when it became apparent to the officers within the murder inquiry that something had taken place that potentially constituted a crime, they referred that to the CCU. The CCU then did some assessment of that and then determined that they needed to progress an inquiry. I'm getting to that. What would have happened at that point is the CCU, at the point where they felt that they had something they needed to investigate, would have updated me in terms of normal practice. I can't give you the date that initially happened, but I can try and find out.
With many questions we wish to pursue, so advise the committee that in our work programme undoubtedly we'll have a whole list of questions, perhaps some of which we'll have to peruse once we've looked at the official report to flesh out more information. Alison and then Rod.
Thank you. Mr Richard Evison has raised three points, I think, that I want to further explore. Did you actually find a leak?
That's, again, information that without wanting to be obstructive, I don't think I can make comment on due to the potential subsequent activities. IPT.
If you have found a leak, is that compromised by, the action that you might be able to take? Has that been compromised by your own breaches? Well, not your, Police Scotland's own breaches? of this legislation?
I don't believe there's a compromise there, no.
Okay. The Emma Caldwell case collapsed, am I right, in 2007? But you've spoken about a live murder inquiry. Can you give us some more information around about how active that was?
So, in effect, any undetected murder, and the Emma Caldwell inquiry was, we categorise investigations, and this was the highest level of categories, a category A murder. And so the number of people that are associated with the inquiry is at the highest possible level. An undetected crime at that level is never shut down. It remains live all the way through. And ultimately, even when lines of inquiry have kind of dried up, what happens with the passage of time because of advances in forensic opportunity, advances in a whole series of different things. There are constant reviews that take place to see if there are any new lines of inquiry that emerge that would enable further progress to be made. And on this particular set of circumstances, it has remained live all the way through. Reviews have systematically taken place, and on the 25th of May, the Lord Advocate instructed that this was escalated up to a full category kind of approach, and therefore appropriate resourcing was put around it. So that's the kind of chronology and sequence.
Oh, sorry, if it was already a category A, how could it be raised any higher?
Well, in effect, because, as I say, if you're into the review kind of phase, what happens is that sits, it's still a live inquiry and it's still a category A, but because the inquiry lines have kind of dried up, it then goes into the ownership of a team that effectively just do that constant review. At the point where either because of something they've found in review or in this instance when the Lord Advocate has said he's looking to take it to the next level, then we take it back out of that unit that deals with the review and resource it accordingly so that effectively you have more asset available to do hands-on work.
So at the time that you were investigating what you thought was a leak, was it after the Lord Advocate had instructed that resources were put to it, or was it prior to that when it was in that sort of review process that it had obviously been in since 2007?
Sorry, I'll need to check that and I'll come back to
you. If you could, that would be great. And finally, Convener, if you'll indulge me, you said earlier it was only a subscriber check. Subscriber checks are phone records on time and location, is that right? So who people are talking to, where they were, when they did it, and how often they're doing it, is that correct?
No, a subscriber check is simply the owner, the details relating to a telephone number. There's no information provided with who they're speaking to or any additional information.
But you would have how often that person was contacted?
No, it's simply, a subscriber check is simply who does that telephone number belong to.
Thank you.
Can I ask further to the letter from the PF? Can we see that letter? Is that the public domain as well?
The PF?
The letter of the 25th of May, asking you to escalate the inquiry up, the murder inquiry further.
I didn't mention a letter. I simply said the Lord Advocate asked for that process. It may well be there's a letter. I'm honestly not
sure.
Well,
it'd be useful to know what prompted the Lord Advocate, apart from various other things, whether it was to do with press reports, how that fell into the, how that came about into the system, that made the police look again at this case, not just the usual reviews of unsolved cases. Rod, you're the last.
Yeah, a couple of points. Just about on this question of judicial authorisation. The Code of Practice requires it for communications data applications to term journalistic sources and sets out three bullet points in the next bit of information that could be used to consider to determine journalistic sources, including data relating to journalist communication addresses, the communication addresses of those persons suspected to be a source, and communication addresses of persons suspected to be acting as intermediaries between the journalist and the suspected source. So there's quite a lot of detail available to you. Are you still saying that Detective Superintendent Donaldson gave full regard to that?
I can only say what I've already said. As far as I'm concerned. He has given appropriate consideration as he saw fit to do his job and adhere to the guidelines. It's subsequently been determined that that was incomplete and incorrect. I can't say any more.
Okay.
D.S. Donaldson can.
Yeah,
so.
Okay. Well, the question of requiring judicial authorisation, put that in context, was that a one-off or are there other forms of application, not necessarily this, which would require judicial authorisation, which Detective Superintendent Donaldson might have been familiar with, or is it really a one-off?
Well, I'm not sure I understand what you're asking.
Well, basically, would Detective Superintendent also be used to having to get judicial authorisation for other, not necessarily this kind of journalistic source, but other kinds of application, or is it?
No, I mean, I think, you know, he's very familiar with the rigours of authorisation that in different ways require different standards. You know, I've said that since this has happened with the specific regard to judicial journalistic protected professions, there have been no requests. So this isn't something that's happening on a day-to-day basis. But largely, he is familiar with the necessity of applying legislation into a decision-making process. That's his profession. That's what he does. And again, on this instance, he's tried his level best to do that appropriately, and the rest is history.
I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much for your giving your evidence this morning, and I think, as I'd advise, the committee will consider its next steps in relation to this matter later today. And I'm going to suspend I'll give you a suspension till 11:30 if you're content with that. That was a long session. Okay, thank you. resuming. And before we move on to the second panel with regard to IOCO, because we've taken so long, quite rightly, over the first panel of witnesses, I'm suggesting that we take item 3, Abuse of Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill, we do that the first week back, and that will give us a proper attempt, you know, real questions and that. There's a lot we want to ask in that, and we can that would be the best way forward. And I'm advised that the Cabinet Secretary will be available to do it. Have I your agreement? Thank you very much. Right, panel 2, and I now welcome Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Scottish Government officials from Police Division, Ian Kernohan and Graeme Waugh. And Cabinet Secretary, you wish to make an opening statement?
Convener, I'm happy just to go straight to questions.
Questions, thank you. Oh, I like the sound of that. Roddy, Elaine, Rod.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Morning. You perhaps start by outlining the kind of formal relationship between IOCO and the Scottish ministers?
Well, IOCO is a reserve body which is accountable and reports to the Prime Minister. Scottish ministers have got no direct control over IOCO or its function because it's set out within the Regulation for Investigatory Powers Act 2000, and any reports from IOCO regarding investigations into public bodies go directly to those public bodies rather than to Scottish ministers, or they would go to the Prime Minister. So there's no direct accountability as such or authority in Scottish ministers over IOCO and how it functions.
How do you feel about that? Do you think that's satisfactory?
I think there's always room for improvement. I would certainly like to see improvement around this. So, for example, if there was any Scottish public body being investigated by IOCO into a matter, I think it would be reasonable for Scottish ministers to be notified of that so that we were aware of that taking place. As it stands at the present moment, that doesn't happen. I think it would be better if there was an automatic notification of Scottish ministers. I also think it would be useful that where there is an investigation into a Scottish public body by IOCO, and that they have completed an inspection report of that particular public body, that too should also be provided to Scottish ministers as it stands. The committee will be aware that the UK government are planning to revise the Regulation for Investigatory Powers Act next year, and part of that will also involve changes to the commissioner role. So, for example, the Office of the Surveillance Commissioner, and the proposal is that the Office of the Surveillance Commissioner and the IOCO role come into one, and having one single oversight commission. I think it would be helpful at that particular point if we had a situation where in legislation there was a clear line through the new commission to Scottish ministers to report on any matters relating to devolved bodies that are responsible for functions under this area of reserve legislation.
If I can turn perhaps to IOCO's reports. In the previous section, I referred to a February 2015 report from IOCO. I don't know if you're able to help the committee in advising whether a copy of that was supplied to Scottish ministers, or when was your first kind of communication in relation to these matters?
We didn't receive an advance copy of the report. I understand that report went to the Home Office. My understanding, though, is that that report is in the public domain now, which is available. That refers to the work that was undertaken by IOCO in October 2014 and then published in February of this year, which resulted in the code of practice that was introduced on the 25th of March. So, but my understanding is that report's in the public domain now, but it didn't come to Scottish ministers in advance.
So can you help the committee by saying when you first became aware of the code of practice and then in turn of a possible breach of it?
Both the code of practice and when it was breached? Is that the question?
Well, potentially two questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we were made aware of the intention for a code of practice by Home Office ministers at the end of February of this year. and their intention that the code of practice would be introduced in February. It's worth keeping in mind, and I noticed in some of the exchanges earlier on, individuals were referring to changes in legislation. There has been no legislative change. This is a code of practice. The reason it was introduced as a code of practice because there was no time available at Westminster in order to introduce it through legislation. My understanding is that the Home Office intend that in the changes to the regulation investigated powers legislation is to put the statutory provisions which exist in the existing code of practice into the legislation, so it's got a statutory footing for future reference. But that's, as I say, we would advise at the end of February that it would begin introduced in March of this year. And we were made aware of the breaches of this at the beginning of July of this year. And I was then formally given a briefing in this matter by ACC Nicholson in July, I think it was the 15th, on this particular matter and the full extent of the issue.
And can you tell us about that briefing?
Yeah, it was primarily off from part of which you already know. IOCO had undertaken their inspection of Police Scotland between the 15th and 17th of June. During the course of that, they'd identified areas where there were breaches in the code of practice that had come in March. They had relayed that information to Police Scotland, and that Police Scotland were now undertaking a review as a result of those findings, which would then be submitted to IOCO. And that review was then submitted to IOCO at the beginning of August of this year. My primary concern was to make sure that Police Scotland were cooperating with IOCO in any breaches which they had identified, that matter was being looked at in detail, which they confirmed, which was part of the review work which they were undertaking for IOCO, and also that they would then address the deficiencies that had resulted in these breaches occurring in the first place. They confirmed that once the review had been completed, they would then be in the process of looking at establishing an action plan in order to address these issues. What we also did in the interim was to contact IOCO to confirm with them that Police Scotland were cooperating and working with them on the issues that they'd identified, which they confirmed, and also that once the review had been completed, that the appropriate action plan would then be taken forward in order to prevent these breaches from occurring in the first place.
You were asked in Parliament on a number of occasions, I think, to confirm whether or not Police Scotland was one of the forces that had been referred to in ICOCO, but you refused to provide that information. Could you just clarify for the committee's benefit why you took that view?
Well, the context of this is that Police Scotland are no different to any other police force in the UK on the governance and oversight of the use of this legislation for the purposes for which it's intended. And that's IOCO's responsibility in order to undertake that oversight and the accountability role that goes alongside that. They identified in their interim report in mid-July that there were two forces in the UK which they were investigating in relation to possible breaches of the code. That understandably generated interest around whether Police Scotland was one of them or not. IOCO's view was that given that that was an ongoing investigation and given that they were continuing to look into the issue, it wouldn't be appropriate for them to name any of the forces who were involved in those investigations. And we accepted and respected IOCO's position on this. They set out themselves in their own public statement as to why it wouldn't be appropriate to name those individual forces on the basis of the nature of investigation, potential implications it could have for any further work which they were undertaking, and also for the individuals who may have been affected by any breaches. And we respected the position that they'd set out, and the view we came to was that they should continue to undertake the role on the basis on which they had set out, that it should that those two forces should not be identified while they were completing their investigation process.
Thank you. Thank you. And what do you see the role of HMICS and SPA in this matter, the Scottish Police Authority?
Well, I think we've got to distinguish two different things here. Is that my understanding is that HMICS will not be undertaking a review of the investigatory powers area that's the responsibility of IOCO, who have got oversight and responsibility for that area. What the HMICS will be responsible for looking at is the procedures and processes around the counter-corruption unit within Police Scotland. And to look at how robust those are, it will be, as I've said to Parliament, it will be an in-depth, thorough, an independent review of those processes, and that the terms of reference for that particular review work is presently being finalised by HMICS in coordination with IOCO, so that it doesn't go over their area of responsibility, and with the SPA before they finalise the heads of that the heads of agreement on that particular investigation.
And the Scottish Police Authority's role?
It will report to, it's the Scottish Police Authority who have requested this by HMICS, and HMICS have agreed to it, and it will then be they will then report to the Scottish Police Authority, and as is always the case with HMICS reports, there will also be a copy laid in Parliament.
Okay. Are other members in?
Yeah, well, it's very kind of you to give me, to tell me my place. I'll now let other members in. That's you down at the bottom of the list next time. Elaine, followed by Gill, please.
Thank you. I can't say, just for clarification, when did you personally first become aware that Police Scotland might have breached the IOCO new code? When did that come to your attention?
It would have been around the 10th of July, and then I was provided with a formal briefing by Police Scotland on the 15th of July by ACC at Nicholson.
Yeah. So what action did you take at that point?
What I've just set out was to seek their assurance that they were complying with the investigation that had been undertaken by IOCO, which they confirmed they were, that they had identified why there had been deficiencies in their process. They were undertaking the review as a result of the findings from IOCO at that particular point into this issue. That work was then being taken forward over the course of July and was submitted to IOCO at the beginning of August by Police Scotland. So that process has already started and was being taken forward. The second thing I was keen to ensure was that action was taken to prevent this type of thing from occurring again in the future. And part of that was for Police Scotland to take forward an action plan in order to address that. That was progressed following the review work which Police Scotland had submitted to IOCO and their findings from their inspection. And we also contacted IOCO to make sure that work was being progressed, and they confirmed that was the case in terms of Police Scotland cooperating with them, and also the review which Police Scotland are now internally undertaking as a result of the issues that had been identified by IOCO.
Have you had sight of the action plan that Police Scotland have?
I have had sight of the action plan, yes.
And you're satisfied that it's...
I'm satisfied with it, and IOCO are satisfied with it as well. As I said in their own public statement, it's a robust range of measures which Police Scotland have put in place in order to prevent this type of thing from happening again in the first place. And I'm satisfied that they have changed the arrangements in order to prevent something like this from happening again in the future.
When I posed that question to the Scottish Police Authority about action they took, it appeared basically the SPA hadn't taken any action. They sat back and said it's a matter for IOCO. As the organisation which the legislation passed by this Parliament scrutinises Police Scotland, were you surprised that they didn't, that the SPA wasn't more proactive in terms of Police Scotland? They didn't ask any questions?
Well, my understanding is that the SPA were provided with a briefing by Police Scotland on this issue on at the beginning of July as well, so that they were aware of the findings or the initial findings from IOCO's review of Police Scotland's procedures in this area. It is worth keeping in mind, though, the statutory responsibility for oversight in this area lies with IOCO.
Indeed,
that's based in statute.
That is their responsibility. And there's an issue about the SPA having oversight in an area which is out with their control.
But equally, the Police Scotland has not had a particularly easy year with a number of different issues coming up. And would you not expect SPA to be a bit more concerned that yet again there was bad publicity around Police Scotland?
Well, I've no doubt they'd be concerned, but the point I'm making is that in terms of oversight, responsibility for oversight in this area of legislation is with IOCO. It's the exact same for Police Scotland as it is for any other police force or any other public body in Scotland in these issues. So what happens in Police Scotland is no different to what happens in any other police force in the UK, with IOCO having responsibility for this area. Now, I do think it's important, though, that there are lessons that I think can be learned from this. And the actions by the SPA to request HMICS to undertake a review of the some of the procedures and practices within the counter-corruption unit, I think, is useful. And I would fully expect, if there are any findings from the HMICS review in this area, for the SPA to then pursue these matters with Police Scotland and to ensure that they are appropriately and fully implemented.
IOCO said that the actions of Police Scotland had been reckless. I wonder, could you say what you understand by the definition of the term reckless? I mean, it's used in legislation. It's in the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Bill, which we're having to postpone. What do you understand is the definition of the term reckless?
Well, I suppose in terms of the definition, you'd have to put that to IOCO, who've obviously made the determination on that basis. There are essentially two levels, I believe, that IOCO can make a determination this year. It's whether it's willful or whether it's reckless. In this case, having considered the matter, they've decided that the issue was reckless. There was the distinction being there was no deliberate act on the part of officers within Police Scotland to willfully not apply the code in itself, but they have been reckless in failing to actually apply it in the way in which it was intended, which could have had an impact on individuals who are affected by that. But the final definition around the determination is a matter you would have to pursue with IOCO, given it is their responsibility to come to these determinations.
DCC Richardson seemed to imply that the definition was in some way confidential. Does that surprise you?
Well, again, that would be it would be for IOCO to explain that to you if they do not intend to explain how they have come to that particular definition. But my understanding is that the marked difference between it being willful and reckless is that there was no deliberate attempt. And in fairness, IOCO have stated that as well. And Police Scotland have made that clear in their own statement following this investigation that there was no deliberate attempt for them not to apply the code. But clearly an error has been made by an officer who I've got no doubt was trying to do his best in relation to the matter, but the code has not been properly applied in this instance. Mm-hmm.
But there is an understanding in Scots law what reckless means because we use it in legislation, isn't it? Do you think that's different? There's a difference that somehow reckless and the IOCO's definition of reckless is somehow not as rigorous as our definition of reckless?
Well, I don't really want to preempt IOCO's explanation of their definition. You would have to pursue that specifically with IOCO, given that it is their definition and their determination.
Gil, please, followed by Margaret Mitchell.
Good morning, Minister. We heard that some of this came about because there was a push for the timeline to come in early. And I wondered what comments you would like to make to that. And was the Scottish Government involved in this push for this to take place quicker?
The timeline relates into the work which was commissioned by IOCO around the way in which the police were obtaining communication data relating to journalistic sources, which started in October the year before in 2014, which then reported to the, I believe it was to the Home Office in February of this year. The timetable for its introduction was a matter for the Home Office. There were concerns expressed around the speed at which it had been introduced, and I believe that the Commissioner himself Sir Anthony May had raised some concerns about that. But I also recognise there was a desire to make sure that this issue was addressed, I suspect, largely prior to the dissolution of the Westminster Parliament, so that arrangements were in place for any requests which were made by the police for this type of communication data to be obtained. So I suspect that was probably one of the biggest factors that had an influence in this issue. Having said that, that may have led to some of the challenges which have been presented, but notwithstanding that, IOCO have identified where there have been deficiencies, and it's important that they're appropriately addressed and actions taken to prevent it from happening again in the future.
And since, and you pointed out yourself, Minister, that this is a code of practice, rather than a statutory, the fact that it was a code of practice, could it have been the case that a decision could have been taken here in Scotland to slow this process up, recognising, or again, is it in hindsight, just because we know what's happened now and because of short time, some of these things have happened?
No, we couldn't have delayed it because it's a reserved area. It's an area reserved legislation. The code of practice was taken forward by the Home Office. So it wasn't an area we were in a position where we could have decided to take a different approach in Scotland. This applied to all forces across the UK. And the time frame was set by the Home Office.
So the pressures were UK-wide, were they? Yeah.
It was for all forces across the UK that are covered by this legislation. So, but we weren't in a position where we could say that this would not apply in Scotland because it was an area that was out with their competence.
And finally, has IOCO been investigating any other Scottish public bodies this year or in previous years? And if so, how many? You might be aware of. I know your limitations because it's reserved, but
I'm not aware of them. Well, they obviously undertake their annual review process of public bodies that have powers under the Regulation for Investigatory Powers Act, but I'm not aware of them having findings against any other public body in these areas. I would expect, as from any inspection process, areas where bodies can always make improvements, but they have not flagged up to Scottish ministers any concerns about any specific public body that around how they're applying Regulation for Investigative Powers legislation or its guidance. Having said that, back to my earlier comment, they would not normally notify us of these matters anyway, because these are matters which are reserved. And they would not necessarily direct any information to Scottish ministers in these instances in the first place.
Even though they are reserved, Minister, do you think it would just be common courtesy to inform the Scottish ministers in that regard, even if it was not to take any action, but just to keep you posted? Or does that take place? Do they keep you posted and it's off the record, or in a way that you're not able to act on it?
It's off the record, and the Cabinet Secretary admits it's on the record. So.
well, neither on the record or off the record.
I was actually meaning informal.
This has been the position for successive governments in the Scottish Parliament. So, because this legislation has been in place since 2000, actually. I was actually on the Justice Committee when we dealt with the Regulation for Investigative Powers.
We were
Scotland
there together, Act. Cabinet so, Secretary. How far you've come and how far I've fallen.
But the, would you call it the as I've mentioned earlier on, I do think in revising this legislation and in looking at changes that can be made to it, one of the areas I do wish to pursue is the issue of making sure that Scottish ministers are notified of any concerns which IOCO have or its successor organisation have around any specific Scottish public bodies that have powers in this area of reserved legislation. I think that's a reasonable thing to expect, and also it provides ministers and to some degree Parliament with an assurance that there is a feedback into Scottish ministers around any areas of concern that have been raised by a commissioner in relation to how a public body in Scotland may be operating in these areas.
Okay, thanks very much,
Matt. I'm just going to take people in order, Alison, because everybody's pretty well in the same thing. Margaret Mitchell, followed by Christian, followed by Alison, followed by Margaret McDougall.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
You've stated on a number of occasions, and again today, that the statutory oversight for the Code of Practice was reserved and it was IOCA's duty. We now have the findings from the investigation. Are there any of these findings, any areas of these findings that the Scottish Government have devolved competence over looking at?
In what way?
Well,
I'm
for
not entirely
example,
clear, but what's
we know
the
there's
point
been
is?
A breach of Article 10, which is the freedom of the press article, and the implementation of the convention is a devolved issue. So what's the Scottish Government's reaction to that?
Well, if I understand your point correctly, there are no recommendations for Scottish Government in the IOCO report. But secondly, the area is an area of reserved legislation, and the Code of Practice is a matter which is reserved, and the oversight of it is reserved as well. The action plan that has been developed by Police Scotland following their own review of the matter, given the initial findings from IOCO. IOCO then conducted their further detailed investigation following the review which they received from Police Scotland in August of this year. And during that period of time, Police Scotland developed their action plan to address the issues that had been highlighted and shared that with IOCO to seek their assurance that the changes which they were making would address the concerns and issues that IOCO had and to prevent a breach like this happening again in the future. IOCO have now stated, yes, they have put robust measures in place in order to prevent this from happening again in the future. So we have assurance from IOCO and from what I saw from the action plan as well, that Police Scotland have taken forward a range of different measures to prevent something like this from happening again in the future.
So even though the Scottish Government has responsibility for the implementation of the convention and there has been a breach of one of the articles, Article 10, then the government has no responsibility or does nothing else to follow up on that, given they have devolved competence for the implementation of the convention.
I'm not entirely sure of the logic of this, but the issue around, yes, there is Article 8 and Article 10 are issues, I believe, that relate to some aspects around this. However, the oversight and the legislation it relates to are reserved areas, and the action which is being taken has been agreed that it is the appropriate measures in order to prevent this from happening again in the future. I'm not entirely sure what else you would expect the Scottish Government to do.
Well, I suppose just look round the whole implementation of Article 10 and see if there's anything within the organisation, because I think the committee is very frustrated. The SPA never seemed to be hands-on and we always have another assurance review and never seem to have too much teeth. So if there's an implementation of human rights aspect, I'm merely checking that the Scottish Government is quite confident in its own mind and you in your mind that you've done everything possible to make sure there aren't any breaches of these articles, which we have devolved confidence in a kind of wider view of what's going on in school Police Scotland. Now that this has been highlighted, and it is a very, very serious issue, as I'm sure you appreciate, freedom of speech in any democratic society is absolutely fundamental.
I'm mindful that some people would like to abolish the Human Rights Act and remove it from their statute. So,
perhaps we'd like it to be implemented better than it's currently being implemented.
That's a different debate then,
yes.
Not the one that I'm familiar with, but from the Conservative government at Westminster. But what I can say is that obviously, issues around ECHR were considered by IOCO during the course of their investigation. And they have said that robust measures have now been put in place to prevent this from happening again in the future. I'm confident, given IOCO's expertise in this area and knowledge in this area, that those robust measures are now in place. And having considered the action plan as well, I'm confident that they've put the right measures in place as well. But the member will also be aware that one of the outcomes from an investigation like this is that there is the possibility of an investigative powers tribunal, which can consider these issues further and can consider the extent of the impact it's had on individuals who were affected by this. I'm aware from the media there's already one party has indicated that they would intend to take it to a tribunal. They are then in a position to look at this in more detail on how it's affected that individual and also to look at whether there's any further measures that then need to be taken as a result. So that's a process that's still to be gone through by those individuals who do believe that their rights have been infringed, and they've been notified of that by IOCO, and IOCO then have a responsibility in making sure that they're furnished with sufficient information for the purposes of then taking forward any case through the Investigative Powers Tribunal, which again is a reserved area, which is part of the statutory provisions within this area of legislation.
I think you've answered my question, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Christian, followed by Alison, please.
Good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. Just a point of details, just to clarify, I may be misunderstood, but were you made aware of the change of the code of practice?
We were made aware of the intention to introduce the code of practice towards the end of February this year. I had a discussion with the Home Office Minister, James Brokenshire, who was responsible for taking forward this area within the Home Office.
Did you discuss the implication that a quick implementation will maybe be a problem? Did you forecast in your discussion of any problem that could arise because it was not enshrined in legislation, but it was only a change of code of practice?
Well, part of the challenge here was the issue I was referring to earlier on was that there was no time at Westminster for them to put this on a statutory footing. And they were also mindful that they were intending to look at in post-elections in the new Parliament changes to the investigative powers legislation, which the committee will be familiar with. The UK government have already set out the plan to take forward, and that the most practical way in which to deal with it at this time would be through a code of practice. So clearly there was pressure in Westminster's timetable because of the pending general election, which was coming forward, and there would be challenges in its implementation, and that was a challenge which no doubt the Home Office were aware of, but also it was highlighted by the Commissioner himself. But the decision was to make the Code of Practice available and to put it in place prior to the dissolution of the Westminster Parliament.
Thank you.
And Alison, followed by Margaret McDougall.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, you'd agree, though, that the urgency, if I recall, at Westminster at that time was precisely to protect journalists following attacks on press freedom. So there was an urgent need to do something.
Oh, I do recognise that. And it would be wrong to suggest that we were opposed to this. We welcomed the code of practice, and we actually believe it should be put in a statutory footing rather than as it stands as a code of practice.
That's a helpful clarification. Thank you. This morning, DCC Richardson sought to excuse the breaches of the code of practice by saying that the pace was aggressive and pressured in introducing the guidelines. Would you agree with me that if the DCC was so concerned about that, it would have been reasonable to expect them to have sought to make representations about that, or to ask you to make representations to Westminster about that?
Well, you know, I think it is fair to say that it was a very tight time frame to introduce this code of practice, and there's no doubt there have been some challenges, and part of this may be the most recent findings from IOCO may be in part as a result of some of that timetable.
But I'm also conscious that forces across the UK all had to apply the same rigour to this particular issue. I think it's there were some challenges around guidance being provided to the police through the Home Office and also through IOCO. So, for example, in one area in the timeline, and looking at this, which may be of interest to the committee and obviously in pursuing these issues with IOCO as well, is that the IOCO published its guidance on the independence of the designated person at the beginning of June. So even with the code of practice coming into force as of the 15th of March, there was still a gap in the provision of some of the guidance, which was then being passed on to the police and to other public bodies and other organisations who have pillars in this area. So I think it may have contributed to some of the challenges in these areas, and I think it is reasonable for Neil Richardson to highlight some of the challenges that that did create for them at that particular point.
Yeah, thank you. Police Scotland on a number of occasions have had less regard than I would like them to have to human rights compliance, and I think about what we've had to do in relation to stop and search, and we've got this. So are you comfortable and satisfied that Police Scotland has the necessary expertise within the organisation to fully comply with ECHR, or do you feel that we need to review what's available to them?
Do you mean in terms of legal expertise within the organisation in understanding ECHR?
Are they being properly advised and then able to roll that out through the organisation so that it permeates everything that they do, to be honest?
Well, look, Police Scotland have to be compliant with ECHR in the same way that any other public body in Scotland has to be. And in this particular instance, a mistake has clearly been made by, as you've heard from Neil Richardson this morning, a very experienced officer with a considerable level of expertise in this area. But a mistake has been made, and we need to ensure that lessons are learned from that and to prevent it from occurring again in the future. I'm very conscious that as part of police training and part of their ongoing work is that they are regularly refreshed and advised around human rights issues and implications of these issues, and to make sure that the approaches which they're taking are compliant with these areas in legislation. I've been at briefings within Police Scotland where officers are going out on particular operations where that's been reiterated to them. So I don't think there's a strong recognition within Police Scotland is that they need to be compliant with ECHR and that they shouldn't be acting in a way which compromises that. But clearly in this particular case, there have been deficiencies which have resulted in the wrong judgment being made. But again, I would go back to the point from IOCO in that it wasn't willful, it wasn't a deliberate act in order to misuse the legislation or to deliberately ignore the codes of practice.
Thank you very much. Margaret McDougall, followed by John.
Thank you, and good afternoon.
Afternoon.
I want to ask a question around this judicial approval. And it's in the code of practice where the police request communications of a journalist's source. Is that a new requirement?
For the judicial approval?
Uh-huh.
Yes, it is.
Yes. Right.
So prior to the code of practice coming into force, there was no judicial oversight of it. The code of practice introduced a judicial oversight. There are two key areas that the new code of practice introduced. One was the provision of the designated person in authorising a request for this type of communication data. The second part was judicial oversight in that around journalistic sources. So the code of practice was introducing new provisions in order to provide stronger safeguards in this area, because the report that IOCO had started in October 2014 was specifically looking around this issue
around how the police were using these measures when it came to journalistic sources. And the two key parts of the code of practice are the designated person and also the judicial oversight.
And this was in March that this code of practice came out.
25th of March it came into force.
So you would expect an officer with the expertise that we've heard that Detective Superintendent Davidson had. Donaldson, the 2 points that you've just pointed out, that he would have picked up on that, that the main differences are, and that he would have been able to identify that he needed judicial approval to look into that.
Well, as you've heard from Neil Richardson this morning, their explanation as to how that's not come about, in that the officer who was dealing with it has taken a very narrow view of the request rather than considering some of the wider issues, which resulted in them coming to a judgment which meant that the code of practice has not been applied in the way in which it should have. And the oversight function through IOCO, through their inspection of Police Scotland, has identified the deficiency and asked them to review that matter and for them then to put appropriate measures in place to prevent it from occurring again in the future. So I think Neil Richardson's better placed than I, from an operational point of view, to explain the process that the police use in taking these matters forward. But clearly, an error has been made. And that in these cases, judicial oversight of the decision should have taken place.
Thank you. If I could just move on to that. The action plan, which was a result of the review, had 12 points on it, and all of the 11 action plan points have been executed, as far as I know, except for the one on judicial reviews and approval. Is that not of concern to yourself, given that, you know, that was the issue?
My understanding is that Police Scotland are already in the process of putting in place the right judicial process for that.
That's what you told us this morning.
Yeah, they're in the process of putting in place the formal process to ensure that that happens, that mechanism is available to them for any future decisions in these areas. Mm-hmm. But so it's not a case of that they're not doing it. It's in the process of resolving that area identified within their action plan.
So it's not implemented if it's not resolved?
Well, they're working to implement it just now.
I think a point of information, Margaret. The updated code of practice now requires the police to seek judicial approval in such circumstances. Uh-huh. So it's not a review. It's just, I think you mentioned.
No, but in the action plan that we spoke about earlier,
one of the
points was that around the judicial approval, and I forget the title, Mr. Richardson, who was here this morning, he said that they had all been implemented apart from the one around judicial implementation.
So they're in the process of taking forward that particular that particular action point within their plan. Mm-hmm. It's clearly in Police Scotland's interest to make sure that that is addressed, mm-hmm. because if they don't have that, then they won't be in a position where, if they deem it necessary to look at obtaining communication data and it relates to the provisions within the code of practice, then they will have to have the judicial authorisation process.
So I think the point I was trying to make is that it's not discretionary, it's mandatory. They've got to, if these other tests apply.
Of course. Yeah, they will have no choice.
They haven't exercised it yet. It's not complete as far as their action plan is. That's the point I'm making. Yeah. So we don't have that as yet.
Well, we'll leave it at that just now, John.
Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, you've laid out a very clear timeline of the Scottish Government's engagement on this particular issue, and I'm grateful for that. We heard a less than clear position put forward by Mr. Richardson. Maybe that clarity will come with all the various follow-up notes he's going to give us. What you've commented frequently about statutory oversight, and I think we all understand that the role there is for that. Once again, the police authority look like bystanders. They look like onlookers to a process, always playing catch-up. We're told that in August of this year, they received a briefing from Police Scotland. And 3 or 4 months later, the Institute an assurance, yet another. And I hope Mr. Penman's getting additional resources for all this additional work he's doing, because he's a perennial... I'm sure you'll have him in mind. But there is a very serious issue here, and that is, I wonder what role you see for the police authority. They're effectively making themselves redundant. When they do become involved, it's playing catch-up. It's calling on the good services of Mr. Penman and his staff, and I think we should all be grateful for the diligent work they've done in relation to stop and search and armed policing and the rest. Are they doing themselves a job?
No, I don't agree with that. Are there areas for improvement? Of course there are. Are there ways in which the Scottish Police Authority can ensure that they are undertaking robust and challenging oversight of the way in which Police Scotland are operating to identify areas where they believe that improvements could be made? The SPA do a range of that, but there's always room for improvement. I don't think the SPA would say there is not room for improvement as well. But I don't want to, you know, I think it is worth though reiterating the point is that oversight in this area does, on a statutory basis, lie with IOCO in the same way it does for every other police force in the UK. I think there is room for improvement around how IOCO engages with some of the oversight bodies that may have a role around policing in general, and how that they share information with them. So, notwithstanding your own view in the matter about the need for the SPA to try and get ahead of the curve, which is what I presume your central point is, I think it is worth keeping in mind that the statutory oversight in this area is the responsibility of IOCO in the same way it is for every other police force in the UK.
Yes, appreciate it's a reserved matter, I know you're not suggesting total disengagement. We also have other groups. We have the Information Commissioner, the Surveillance Commissioner, and perhaps most importantly, more locally, PIRC. It must be that there's a bit of proactivity that's required of the police authority. This committee can do it. The subcommittee on policing can do it. They have been behind the curve on every major issue.
Well, you know, there are, as I've already mentioned, there is areas for improvement, and we have a new chair in place who's undertaking the governance review at this present moment, which will report in the spring of next year, to look at how we can improve governance more effectively around certain policing matters. And I'm keen to make sure that we make progress in that area as well. So there's, I think over the last 2, almost 3 years now is a good time for us to look at how we can improve the governance process and the oversight process, and that work has already been undertaken. But I do think it's also important, though, that we don't lose sight of who does have the statutory oversight in this particular area, given that that's what we're considering here today, and the way in which that operates. And I do think, given the type of architecture we now have in Scotland around policing and the oversight of policing and the way in which it operates, I think the changes that are made to the Commissioner's role around the regulation of investigatory powers gives us an opportunity for that better to reflect that changing relationship and the changing type, the different type of architecture we now have in place for oversight of policing in Scotland.
Thank you very much.
Much of this Cabinet Secretary takes place against the backcloth of the Emma Caldwell murder and accelerating the case again. It was interesting that the Procurator Fiscal wrote to Police Scotland on the 25th of May 2015 to tell them to accelerate matters. I haven't seen the letter. And while I respect the independence of government from the Prosecution Service, do you know anything about that letter?
You need to pursue that matter with the Crown Office, so you don't know about that directly.
Yes. I raise this because of the, while we're talking about process here, I think as a background, it is what was really this all about at the end of the day? The questions arise about Police Scotland reads things in the paper, who's leaking this, they do stuff, we must accept that the IOCC say it wasn't willful but was reckless, but it's not happening in a vacuum. And then in the middle of all this, the investigation into this historic murder case takes a step up. And that's just what I'm wondering about, where this all comes into, but you're not in any part aware of any of that.
Well, it is a live investigation, and it wouldn't be appropriate for ministers to start commenting on a live investigation, but you would have to, in order to explore further the Crown Office's views on these matters, you would have to pursue that directly with them.
Right, that's fine. Thank you very much. Thank you. And thank you for your evidence. Do you have no other questions? Okay. I'll suspend for a couple of minutes. Instrument, the litigants in person, costs and expenses, Sheriff, Appeal Court Order 2015, SSI 2015/398. This order would allow a party litigant to recover certain sums in relation to civil proceedings in the Sheriff Appeal Court where an order of expenses had been made in their favour. The DPLR committee did not draw any concerns on the instrument to our attention. Have you any comments? Are members content to make no recommendation? We now move on to item one. That's we move into private session.